One lady says, "Do you know that genies take things literally?" And it shows then a man in the garage rubbing an old brass thing. And up pops a genie. And the genie says, "What do you want?" And the man says, "Give me $1 million." And the next scene is, there's deer all around you. And then it shows the man's face. And he mustn't have been a deer hunter, because his face was like, "Oh no, what did I ask for?" The Lord knows we humans often don't pray and we give excuses. One excuse is, "Well, I don't know what to ask the Lord for." Another excuse is, "Well, I'm afraid to pray to the Lord in my own words because I might say something wrong. I might get the words wrong." For the Lord gave us many prayers. He gave us the Lord's Prayer and many other prayers we can pray to Him. And one of which is the Advent Prayer. That's our text for today. A prayer that can be summed up in the following words: "Come, Lord, with your power and deliver us." Our text begins. "O Lord, you are our Father, you made us into your people. Our Redeemer from of old is your name." God, you made us. Now, it's really interesting about this text because God inspired the prophet Isaiah to write it before the children of Israel or Judah would need to pray it. And it shows us that God takes care of us so much, He even gives us the words we need for future situations that we get into. The text continues, "Oh, that you would rend the heavens and open the skies and come down. That you would appear, O Lord, and save us, and that the mountains would tremble before you, as when the fire sets twigs ablaze and causes water to boil. Come down to make your name known to your enemies, and cause the nations to quake before you." Basically, these are all pictures and metaphors of God. Use your power and defeat your enemies. For when, or in the past, you did awesome things that we didn't expect. You came down and the mountains trembled before you. You know, our ancestors didn't expect the way you, O Lord, freed us from slavery in Egypt. How you sent the 10 plagues, how you parted the Red Sea, how you led us through the desert, how you brought us to that Mount Sinai and the mountain quake. Lord, they were astonished when the walls of Jericho came tumbling down. They were just astonished. And it shocked them when the Lord gave Gideon and 300 men victory over the Midianites. They marveled earlier that when the Lord defeated the armies of Assyria without Israel even shooting once. They didn't expect those things, because since ancient time, no ear one has heard, no eye has perceived, no eye has seen any God beside you who acts on behalf of those who wait for you. You're the only God who actually acts to save those who wait upon you, who trust in your promises. Every other god is a product of man's imagination, an idol built by them. They come up with an idea of what they want in a god. And in the old days, they take wood and they take stone, they take precious metals, and then they would pray to it saying, "Save me, you are my God." However, their gods would do nothing to save them. For example, remember the false god Baal. He was ruling during the time of Elijah. And Elijah was a faithful prophet. And God said, "Now the time has come." And Elijah got the people of Israel before him and all the false prophets. And he says, "Now choose for yourself. Say, you call on the name of the Lord and I'll call on the name of the Lord." And the God who answers by fire is God. And so Baal prophets began to pray. They prayed most of the day. And Elijah, he's kind of an interesting fellow, because he said, "Oh, maybe he's asleep. Maybe shout louder." And they shouted louder. And then they began to cut themselves. And they did all these things. And nothing happened. Their God did not answer their prayers. And then Elijah, who had waited 3 years for the Lord to show his power to the stubborn idol worshippers and his enemies, he got on his knees and he said, "Oh Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you're God in Israel and that I'm your servant and have done all these things at your command. Answer me, O Lord, answer me so that these people will know that you, O Lord, are God and that you're turning their hearts back again." And then the fire of the Lord fell and burned up the sacrifice, the wood, the stones, the soil, and also licked up the water in the trench. The Lord God acted on behalf of Elijah, and nobody expected it. Our text declares, "You come to the help of those who gladly do right and who remember your way." The Lord helped Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, Joshua, Gideon, Elijah. The list would just go on and on. All these Old Testament believers who remembered the Lord's ways as they waited. They waited for the Lord to deliver them from enemies in this world and for the Lord to send a Savior to come. Now at this point, some of you might be wondering what this prayer has to do with you or any other Christian today. You know, all these words were given long ago. These words given long ago express the faith of those who waited for the Lord to save them. And you're also waiting for the Lord to save you. You're waiting for the Lord Jesus to come and to give you eternal life. In addition, as you wait, you too are surrounded by enemies. Enemies of the Lord who will do anything they can to separate you from them, to lull you to sleep, to ignore Jesus' words. Be alert. You don't know when that time will come. It's like a man going away. He leaves his house and puts his servants in charge, each with his assigned task, and tells the one at the door to keep watch. Therefore, keep watch, because you don't know when the owner of the house will come and get back, whether in the evening or at midnight or when the rooster crows or at dawn. If he comes suddenly, not let him find you sleeping. But I say to you, I say to everyone, watch. And these enemies will use the same tactics against us as they used against God's people in the Old Testament. Although many do not know or ignore the truth, that the false gods in the Old Testament were idols that often promised earthly prosperity. Well, whoever worshipped them, they promised you to worship earthly prosperity. For example, if you would offer them silver, you'd give them gold. You might even offer them your own body, or you might offer them your children's body so that your fields would be fertile and you would have plenty to eat and prosperity. It was real simple. You do this for your idol, and you'll get what you want. And in this regards, the worship of idols were some ways more enjoyable and more entertaining than the worship of the true God at the temple. And plus, the idols, prophets, and teachers, they didn't tell people to wait for the Savior to come. They'd be sexually pure. No, they didn't tell people that. They tell people to repent. They didn't call them to repent or to confess their sinfulness and trust in the Lord who's going to send that Savior, obey his commands as he waits. What they proclaimed was, you could do what you want. You don't need to repent. You can do whatever makes you feel good. And this idol of yours, this false god of yours, will bless you and it'll make you feel good because all you need to do is give him some offerings. And the same is true of the Lord's enemies today. They will tell you, there's no need for you to repent. They tell you, you can make your own god and in your own commandments, what you is right and what's wrong. And you don't need to pray. You don't need to be on your guard or be alert. Keep watch, because your God is a loving God who will never send anyone to hell. Just give your idol some offerings, and he won't punish you for your sins. And it's just look at all the people out there that's doing that. And they're prospering. You can do it as well, and you can prosper. And in addition to that, the sad truth is that many who call themselves Christians are more familiar with the advertisements of this world than God's Word. They don't use the time before Christmas, the Advent season, to prepare to meet their Savior. They use it just to prepare for an earthly Christmas. Oh, they buy and they decorate and they celebrate, but they close their ears when they're told to pray, "Come, Lord Jesus, and deliver us." Partly because they don't want Jesus to come and deliver them until after Christmas. You know, until after the gifts are opened and all the good times are had. Some don't want Jesus to come at all because they're having too much fun in this world. Which leads some faithful believers to ask, keeping Jesus' words in mind, if those days, the days before his second coming, had not been cut short, no one would survive. But for the sake of the elect, those days have been served. To ask, how many pray, O Lord, your Redeemer, our Father? Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains would tremble before you, as when the fire sets twigs ablaze and cause water to come down to make your name known to your enemies and cause the nations to quake before you. How many pray that prayer? Lord, come with your power and deliver us. Do you? We move on to the next words of the prayer. But when we continue to sin against them, you were angry. Now, the Lord sent his prophets in the Old Testament calling people to repent over and over again. And they tell some to shut up, but they often just rejected the message. They refused to repent. The prayer goes on. How then can we be saved? We don't listen to the message of repentance. All of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. Lord, we refuse to repent. We refuse to listen to your word. We have nothing, Lord, to offer you. We are sinful and unclean. We all shrivel up like a leaf. We get old. And like a wind, our sins sweep us away. Our sins hold us captive. Our sins at times move us to go here and there and everywhere. No one calls on your name, worships and prays to you, O Lord, or strives to lay hold of you. They make an effort to have faith and trust in you. And for that, you have hidden your face from us and made us waste away to suffer because of our sin. You know, those words make it appear as if all is lost, doesn't it? Yet that prayer continues. It says, O Lord, you are our Father. Lord, you created us. We are the clay. You are the potter. We are all the work of your hand. Lord, if we're going to change, if we're going to repent, if we're going to keep watch, you need to move us to do that. We can't do it. You know, we're clay. Clay doesn't have any power to shape itself. It needs a potter to shape it. Lord, we need you to come and turn us from our evil ways to your ways, to lead us to repent. And then that prayer goes on in this chapter of Isaiah. Lord, have mercy on us. Lord, come with your strength and deliver us. Again, this section of the prayer applies to many Christians today. You know, many people know how to pray, that know to pray, Lord, give me this, Lord, give me that, Lord, help me in 15 minutes, save 15% of my insurance. But they don't know to pray, Lord, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner who can't change my ways by myself. And who can't even come to repent. Lord, come and use your strength to change my heart so that I will be blameless on the day of my Lord Jesus Christ. You know, some often ask, why is it that many don't know that prayer or they don't pray it? And you know, first off, some come up with all sorts of excuses why people don't do it, reasons for they don't. Some of the more, some blame themselves. They say, you know, if we were more entertaining, if we were better at preaching and teaching God's word, then more people would believe and pray, come Lord Jesus. And there are some that blame others. They say, you know, if they were more entertaining, if they used methods of the world, if they used more contemporary things in worship, if they focused more on helping people in this world, and so on, then more would come to believe and pray, come Lord Jesus. And some blame the media. It's the TV's fault. And if it's not the TV's fault, it's the internet's fault today. It's everybody else's fault. You know? And there's some truth to all those things. But few use Jesus' parable of the sower and the seed, and that seed being God's word, to answer why many do not pray, Jesus, come. In that parable, Jesus gives three reasons why many don't believe in prayer. The first, some do not believe because they hear God's word and the devil takes it away. There's enemies out there. Some hear God's word, they believe it and rejoice of it, but they don't have any root. So when the tough times come, when they experience the attacks of the Lord's enemies, you know, the Lord's enemies attack his people. Which, in these attacks, are not pleasant. They give up believing in Jesus. And they give up believing, come, Lord Jesus. Some hear and believe that the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, the desires for other things come and choke the world. Choke out the word. You know, many of the Old Testament turned from the Lord to these idols of this world that promised them prosperity in this world. And so also many New Testament believers turn from the Lord to the things of this world. They believe that if they were given $1 million, then everything would be good. They believe the message of this world that in the media over the Word of God. Get the things of this world. And they end up worshiping the things of this world. Now, when we look at our life, and let's be honest, at times we do worry about how we're going to get those things in the world, right? We do worry. And then when we look, we see so many people worshiping at the idol of this world, the things of this world. You know, when we hear of Americans converting to Islam, Christians converting to Islam, when we hear of these armies killing and murdering people, and people converting to that religion, sometimes we think, you know, it's all lies. There's no hope. The enemy's going to win. Nevertheless, all is not lost. Hear and believe the Lord saved some. Jesus ended that explanation of that parable with these words. He said, others, like seed sown on good soil, hear the word, accept it, produce a crop 30, 60, or even 100 times than what was sown. Hear and believe that the Lord did move the people of Judah to repent, to pray that he come and save them. And the Lord did. He brought them back to the promised land, to their land. He brought them, and then he sent his one and only son to save sinners like you. Hear and believe that though all appear to be lost, when our Savior was being beaten by Pilate's soldiers and being hung on the cross and he died, Jesus rose from the dead. Believe that he who raised Jesus, our Lord, from the dead, who was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. Hear and believe that the Lord will keep you strong to the end. You will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God, who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, is faithful. And through his powerful word, the Lord can shape you and many others as a potter shapes clay. He can shape you into a believer who prays. Come, O Lord, with your power to deliver us. Amen.